I'm honored to be part of this presentation. I'm honored to be part of the Greenhouse Initiative. So you want to change the world. Thought about that title very carefully, and I hope you thought about the title very carefully. Now, it was either a title that was chosen because it's catchy or something, or the title was chosen for a very precise reason, because you can imagine that there are synonyms for it. Make a difference. Make a real difference. Make your individual contribution. Slightly squishy phrases, don't you know? No, the title is Change the World. Change the world. Maybe I want to discuss degree. Maybe I actually want to ask some awkward questions. I take the subject very seriously. And if I take the subject seriously, we have to think about it very carefully. And sometimes if you think about a subject very carefully, you've got to be careful that you don't take the sharp edges off. So I hope you're not here this evening to have me say, go, social entrepreneurship is good. I hope you don't want me here to be vaguely, generally encouraging, cheerleading type college pep talk stuff. First, I hope you understand the importance of making social change. I hope you already have concluded this. So do you really need me to say, oh, great, you keep doing this stuff? I mean, I hope you're here because you've already concluded that, so you hardly need me to tell you, yo, you came through the cold for the right reason. I mean, you did, but you don't need me to say that. If we're going to make this useful, let us confront some awkward questions. And I mean confront them. Because if you think changing the world is easy, oh my goodness, you look young. Well, you are all right, so you're allowed that. Well, most of you anyway. But it's not easy. I've been involved with people who've been trying to do it since I was your age, which is an inexpressibly long period of time. So I know it's difficult, and I want to talk about those difficulties. And sometimes they're intellectually difficult, and sometimes they're awkward questions, and sometimes there are questions that are not always asked. Well, I want to ask them this evening, because it's important we should think about these issues. So when I said change the world, I don't mean make a difference. I hope you are making a difference. But change the world implies a degree of scale. The world. Oh, I know you're going to change the world by changing your neighborhood. Yes, I've heard the phrase too. Change your neighborhood is a good idea. Don't not change your neighborhood if you have the capacity to do it. If you can change one floor in village, go ahead and do that. But that's not changing the world. That's not changing the world. Let's confront some of these awkward difficulties. So, India, polio free. Let us celebrate it. It is an accomplishment, after all. It should be celebrated. India, polio free, 2014. You should weep. Right? That's the problem. For everything we might be tempted to celebrate, there is always this killer problem when we celebrate it. You know it in your heart of hearts. You know what the problem is. You know what the problem is. To celebrate India being polio-free this year should make you wonder, 2014, why did it take so long? The polio vaccine dates from me being a child. Yes, a long time ago. So do we celebrate? Yes, we do celebrate. It is better that India has polio gone. It is better that a variety of countries have eliminated infectious childhood diseases. That is to be celebrated. It is also to be lamented. And that's the intellectual dilemma we already have to encounter. How much do we celebrate? And how much do we lament? And if we celebrate too much, you know what happens. You know what happens. You know what happens in the charitable world. You know what happens in the world of social action. We get a nice, comfortable feeling of self-righteous congratulations. We finally eliminated measles, in a particular country. And we pat ourselves on the back. And we pat all our colleagues on the back. And you know, it's right to do so. I'm not saying that's not an accomplishment. Don't look at me like I want people to get measles. Come now. But that's the first intellectual difficulty. You have this problem of wanting to celebrate something. At the same time, you should have the same simultaneous thought in your head. How long has it taken? It should not have taken so long for that to take place. So, I read lots of things about social entrepreneurship. I read, for example, the newsletter of the Melinda and Bill Gates Foundation, one of the largest charitable organizations on the planet. And that they do good work is undeniable. They do excellent work for child and maternal health in Africa, for example, and that's only one of the things they do around the world. I've read their recent newsletter for 2014, and they observe correctly that there have been improvements on this planet. They're very strong on making the argument, do not despair, things work, things are getting better, don't give up. That's an important argument to make, don't give up. And they point out that there have been accomplishments across a whole range of things. They draw attention, for example, to the improvement in much of the economies of the industrial world, the emerging economies. Quite right, and they have made economic progress. Refer to the great expansion of economic activity in Asia. To the fact that millions of people, tens of millions of people who lived in objective poverty now have a higher standard of living. To be celebrated. Yes, to be celebrated. But I'm an economist, and I'm going to say but. So let us celebrate the accomplishments of Asia. Except, unfortunately, they're driven by a very peculiar circumstance. They're not driven by social entrepreneurship. They're driven by the energy of Asia, the human energy. But that's driven by the fact that a bunch of old men concluded that communism in China was going to be gone. Now, the name is still there. The system is gone. So a couple of old men made a decision. And I have trouble believing that Deng Xiaoping, this poor man is dead now, sat in Asia saying, I think I shall be a social entrepreneur. What I think he concluded is that the existing system was not working and it must be overturned. But that's an odd thought for an old man. He got a couple of other old men, and it was old men. That's not a sexist comment, old men. Mao Zedong is senile and offline, and the old men decide that Asia is in a horrifying situation. Its talent is suppressed, and they will liberate it by getting rid of the communist limitations. But that didn't have to happen, did it? That was the peculiarity of a small number of people in an autocratic state who decided we shall reform ourselves. And they did. I mean, I salute that they came to that decision. What if they had come to a different decision? If they'd come to a different decision, the resurgent economy of China would not yet have begun. There would all be that wasted potential. Now, while I'm prepared to celebrate economic accomplishment, let us notice, before we get too carried away, it was the idiosyncratic decision of a few individuals, and I'm glad it happened, but let us not congratulate ourselves too much about the inevitability of the power of the marketplace. Lovely phrase, which I actually think is correct, except the inevitability of the market economy could have taken in China tomorrow, or another 20 years, or another 25 years. Oh, by the way, in case you forgot, half of the Chinese economy is state-owned. So half of it's free, and half of it is not. And it has a vibrant not-democracy. So let us be careful that we celebrate. Yes, we should celebrate. There's an improvement in Asia. But perhaps we should temper our celebrations by noticing what a near-run thing that was. Other economies in the world, Brazil, for example, India to some degree, have also had resurgent economies. They have had their citizens raised in terms of an economic standard of living, and a significant number of them, also driven by the fact of the peculiar circumstance that the United States, having nearly smashed its financial system to pieces, has flooded the world with money. Go, Brazil, go! Free money helps a lot. Now, I'm glad those countries, don't look at me like I'm anti-Brazil. I'm not anti-Brazil. What a goofy thing to be anti. But that's not the point. I'm asking that we have a realistic view of our world and of its challenges. So when we say that there have been improvements, and they have, in life expectancy, in infant mortality, in the availability of clean water, it has actually improved. In the standard of living in many countries, it has improved. While this is all true, let us be very cautious. Some of it's true by accidental circumstances of individual decisions of politicians who are smarter rather than dumber. And if you look at your planet, there's an ascendancy of smart politicians compared to dumb politicians in the great scheme of things. Perhaps you should pay attention to the media and notice what is actually going on in your world. So yes, celebrate our accomplishments. And then always say to ourselves, for some of the things, it was a near-run disaster. And to say to ourselves, why on earth did it take so long? So we are making improvements. Thousands of organizations, charities, foundations, NGOs, public agencies are making improvements. They are making accomplishments step by step, inch by inch, person by person. One saved kid, one saved family, one extra agricultural farm that is now viable. All of that is true. All of that is true. And so how much longer shall it take? The Gates newsletter, for example, comments that a distinguished group of experts and economists looked at the possibilities on our planet and said by 2035, with the right policies in place, we can take infant mortality in every country in the world and achieve what it was in the United States and the United Kingdom in 1980. Just that should chill your, make your blood run cold, okay? The rest of the world will get to where we were in 1980, and our infant survival rate's higher than the United States, so it'll take longer. And notice the caveat, with the right policies. Take a deep breath. With the right policies. What do you think the odds are between now and 2035 we will have the right policies? In any of the major countries, in stable democracies, the right policies. Never mind in governments that are autocratic, run by vested interests of every conceivable kind known to mankind. I'm sorry. Oh, now you're looking at me like I'm depressing. When you came through the cold and you were depressed enough. Well, I'm sorry. This is an important subject. And I'm going to try to speak truthfully. I'm sure you take it seriously. So now we have to think about it carefully. How much do we celebrate? And how much do we lament? When the same thing is both to be celebrated and to be despaired of. Because there's a problem with all of the charitable endeavor on this planet. While it all should be celebrated, every single charity, big and small, public, private, and quasi-public, should always say to themselves, how could we do it better? No better. That squishy English word, better. What does better mean? Better is one of these wimpy words that you use when you say, my idea is better than yours. It means nothing. No, not better in some goofy, vague sense. Because you know, if your standard is to do something better, who could prove you false? It all becomes a matter of cockamamie opinion. And I don't know, I think a child who's dying It's not about whether the opinion is they're dying. The kid is in distress, the family is in distress, the environment is in wreckage. So, ladies and gentlemen, so not better. Every charity must say to itself all the time and every day, how can we do this? See, you know it. You don't want to think the word because it is a terrible challenge. It is a high challenge. You're thinking, sitting, oh, well, you know, I could see how I could make the world a little bit better. And I'm not satisfied with a little bit better. You see, I want the world changed in my lifetime. So you know what you all the charitable endeavor, and any one of you in this room thinking about doing it. First, figure out how to do something that would benefit the world. Try to make sure it is going to benefit the world, because some of you run amok. And after you're sure it has benefited the world, then say, how can we do it faster? The word is faster. Nobody in their right mind says not to do it. Well, idiots do, but let's exclude all the idiots on the planet. And largely speaking, we know what to do. When you see families and people and children in distress, you hardly have to have a debate with yourself to say, oh, gee, should we fix that? So I think most of us know what needs to be fixed. I think most of us think our world should be changed. I think most of us could generate a list of the things we want changed. And my list is a long one. And that's no longer enough. And if you sit there satisfied that you've helped one person, in your mind must always be the thought, could I have helped two of them? And if you've helped two of them, could I have helped three of them? And if I helped one of them in one day, could I have helped one of them in half a day? What makes you think? We have all the time in the world. Because we don't. We do not have all the time in the world. We do not. Let's take one of the things that, one of the challenges that we should be dealing with to improve our world. The overriding, one of the overriding issues, which the Gates Foundation makes virtually no comment about. And that is, of course, the state of our environment. Or more precisely, climate change. Lovely phrase, climate change. We used to say climate warming, but then that offended people, so we had to change it into climate change. So all around the planet, there are charities trying to improve the agricultural well-being of millions and millions of people who still live off the land. Totally the right thing to do. And if, while all the NGOs are out helping with better seeds and better agricultural practices, farmers to increase their yields, and if our climate scientists are right, and the evidence is of overwhelming extent, then all those agricultural improvements could be blown to hell and back in 10 years if the climate changes sufficiently. And if our planet is going to be stressed out by climate change, likely in your lifetime, don't you look at me, I may die and escape this problem. But you won't. If the climate change is sufficient, all of the improvements we've made in agricultural well-being could be swept aside. Could be swept aside. Every seed, extra seed you plant, every better genetically modified animal. It's also called breeding, by the way, for those of you who aren't farmers and were suddenly offended because genetically modified something got into the conversation when you were trying to be vigilant. I'm a farmer. We've been breeding cattle for 5,000 years. All that could be lost in some kind of climate change fiasco. And you know, you also know this. If our planet is severely stressed by climate change, which looks remarkably likely, who's going to hurt the worst? The rich and the affluent, or the poor and the vulnerable? You know the answer to that question. So, on climate change alone, Can't wait, can't wait. Must take action now. Must take action faster. So for every time we celebrate what we have done, say, my God, is this all we've done? Okay, I'm reflecting being an economist. You know that. I'm the dismal science. No matter what you are celebrating, I will find something wrong with it. I will. It is my professional expertise. But remember, ladies and gentlemen, there is some social value to what I do. Because I have absolutely the right to say, while you are celebrating what you have done, for me to ask you to think what you could have done. There's a big difference between what you have done and what you could have done. Because if you could have saved someone in 5 minutes and you took 3 days, there are people dead because you didn't do what you could have. I'm sorry. For those of you who remember any economics, that's opportunity cost. I shouldn't look at individual faces. That's very, that's a bad thing to do. But see, I recognize some faces. And yes, but it is opportunity cost. It's how we understand how to maximize our impact. And that's what I want to talk to you about. I'm not here telling you to have impact on your world. Sure to God, I hope you've concluded that already. I'm here to challenge you to maximize your impact on the world. I mean maximize it. And that means lots of things. That means asking awkward questions. That means not ignoring the big problems of the world. Yes, so it'd be nice to, you know, so Africa struggles, other countries struggle. And painfully, slowly, we vaccinate children in Africa. And then don't ask ourselves the real questions about Africa. Because the real questions can be awkward. They can be annoying. You're really trying to do things fast. You're trying to maximize your impact. You're really trying to do it speedily. Then you have to ask these nasty questions. So what could you do? So what could you do, Bill? I like talking to him personally sometimes. Hasn't talked back to me yet, but I live in hope. So Bill, want to help all those children in Africa? Fine. There are at least 12 governments that need to be replaced. They're autocratic, so there's no moral problem that they're democratic. They're not even slightly democratic. They're incompetent, corrupt, and racist. So, Bill, you really want to do it quickly? Those governments are the greatest immediate obstacle to the well-being of those citizens. The greatest obstacle to viable economies, the greatest obstacle to personal security, the greatest obstacle. So, Bill, why don't you just go to the soldiers that keep the dictators in place and buy them all off? Like, put them on pension or something. There may be a few practical issues with that idea, but that's a real problem. And we dance around the edges of contentious problems. Incompetent, grotesquely dangerous governments. We do not like to speak of that because it is awkward. Lots of awkward, difficult issues. Because to be a social entrepreneur, if you're going to do it fast, means you ask the awkward questions and you think of creative answers. How creative? Well, you know, I work as Howard does with the commercial entrepreneurs, right? And we are trying to tell our commercial entrepreneurs, create new things, be innovative. You want to build a really for-profit enterprise? Then create it, then be highly innovative. But remember, those men and women want impact on their world, and they want to make some money. You want to save the world. So you see, if I told a commercial entrepreneur, be creative, push your imagination to the max. Oh, please, not one more restaurant, phone app. Please, pray God, not one more. Don't you think for saving the world you should be more creative than someone who's just trying to create a better gadget or even a better machine? You're trying to change the world. You have to drive your mind into creative domains. You have to say, well, how am I going to do it? How am I going to do it faster? How am I going to do it faster? I want to share with you a blog posting from one of my former students. I am privileged to have now taught 23,000 people, which means nothing goes on anywhere in the world where my former students aren't watching on my behalf. What's a great advantage, Edward Snowden doesn't know from security system. I know this person well. The veracity of his words cannot be challenged. It would be unimaginable for him to exaggerate. He's in Africa. He's serving as a volunteer in a school. He and the school social worker are on a home visit for one of his students. I'd just like you to read what he wrote. Accompanying us is Melvin, a boy I've taught for the past 6 weeks in the slums of Nairobi. Like most things he does, Melvin paces dutifully in silence, a heavy and distracted air about him. It is only in the past few hours that I've been struck by Melvin's strange seriousness. But it's been there all along. In the coming days, I will go home and watch homemade videos of my class and extract him from the sea of commonality, his lithe body swinging and singing with the rest of the children, less joyful, less lively. Because of my class surprise earlier in the day, all I really know about Melvin is his dislike of sweets. A basket of Cadbury goodies in front of him, in front of them, the children, had surveyed the shiny wrappings with gleeful curiosity before shyly taking a piece of Kit Kat or Dairy Milk. Melvin, however, had pocketed his treat silently and retreated into his private world. If there exists such a thing as the poor part of a slum, we enter it now. As this ignorant traveler has discovered, gradients of misfortune find their way even into the least habitable of places. A slum is not a community, but rather a quilt of communities stitched together by the common thread of poverty, each patch within its own texture and makeup. Negotiating an uneven dirt pathway in a collapsed wooden fence, we come upon two of these inhabitants squatting on the bleached gravel, nearly motionless. These are Melvin's brother, says Faith, the social worker. They're both younger than Melvin. One is 5, the other's 3 years old. The three boys lead us to the family home, a worn-down metal shack. Though the windowless room is only partially lit, the sprinkled sunlight is sufficiently chilling, decaying in the middle of the rock floor is a damp mattress surrounded by what Westerners might classify as junk, a broken suitcase overflowing with ripped clothes on one end, cracked non-functioning appliances on the other, alongside a collection of dust-covered pots and pans. We're the first adults in this shelter in some time. Melvin's mother died from AIDS 2 years earlier, and her husband, like many Kenyan fathers, had quickly fled. Against the stillness of their blank expressions, I'm not sure who's more intimidated. What do you guys eat? I asked, uncertain if I'm prepared for the answer. Melvin motions to the corner of the room and a tiny tin of vegetable fat. There are no concealed goodies in this container, however, just the white cooking paste that Melvin and his brothers have been eating for the past few months. The two older boys stare ashamedly at the floor. Still alone with the children, I do what comes to mind. Place Melvin's younger brother on my lap and clutch him tightly. If it's possible for a 3-year-old to exude defeat through body language, he does so now. His lifeless posture, permanent frown, and dreary eyes reflect a grimness I have never seen in a toddler. The door opens sharply, and within seconds, a stranger is guiding Faith, the social worker, around the home. Faith later told me that the man had described the way in which the boys had been abandoned and had pleaded for financial assistance to care for them. The day's commotion takes its toll, and the child on my lap tears up with the ordinariness of an overwhelmed three-year-old. Melvin walks over, takes his brother from my hands, wipes away his tears, and showers him with what I can only describe as maternal affection. He holds his brother in stillness until the crying starts to soften. Gradually, the house is silent again. Faith finally returns, having collected the necessary data. "We have to leave," she says. I turn to Melvin, give him an extended hug, and newfound respect for my succinct student. "Be good," I say to him. "Faith will help you." The door closes with a thud, and we're off maneuvering around the sewage and debris on the narrow dirt road. "I forgot my camera," I tell Faith. "Give me a second." The boys are startled when I return, their final surprise of the day. I retrieve the camera, and as I turn to leave, I see a shiny, rumpled Kit Kat wrapping on the floor. Scanning their faces, I realize that one of the boys isn't eating. "You're a good brother," I say to Melvin. Melvin's 9. Faith and I walk together in the cowering sun. My last day in Kenya. If you want to read the whole posting, Tanya is going to have it on the Greenhouse website. So now, why have I read that to you? I am what? Intending to shamelessly manipulate your emotions? Why would I read that to you? I read that to you because, in my mind, that reflects the urgency of the situation. We face these extraordinary challenges. We face these high obstacles. We have to take action. We have to do things faster. We have to do some things that might be contentious. We have to do things which are experimental and may fail. Means you may take development dollars and try something, and it is all a waste. Except, of course, you've proved something doesn't work and profit from it. And try explaining that to the donors when they conclude that the money has been wasted. All difficult choices. And around the world, we've all these problems. So, you know what you should do. What the Gates Foundation is aggressively happy to tell you it's doing. It partners with large numbers of agencies. Now, that sounds like a good thing. And I would tell you partner with lots of agencies. Unless, of course, by partnering with all those agencies, you have been slowed down according to the pace of the slowest agency of the coalition you're working with. You see, ladies and gentlemen, there's nothing easy. There's nothing that can be done that has no difficulty attached to it. You should collaborate, but if you collaborate, it might slow you down. You should collaborate and leverage your activities, but what if it makes you uncreative? What if you're deciding something by committees? Everyone knows how creative committees are. Well, oddly enough, sometimes they can be creative. And sometimes they can be stupefyingly conservative. Do donor organizations, do charities have to be conscious? Do you, if you engage in social action, have to be careful that you don't say anything with sharp edges on it, lest it annoy donors? Must we all walk tread softly? So as not to piss off donors. Is that what's slowing us down? Sorry, ladies and gentlemen. Many things are slowing us down. a lack of willingness to confront great difficulties. In many countries, the government is the obstacle. Talk about Africa. You know perfectly well that we could go to some Aboriginal communities where the conditions would not be much different. You know perfectly well that we could go to some inner city neighborhoods where the conditions are not that much different. In the developed and in the developing world. This is not just about Africa. This is about the social distress of many communities in many places. Yet even here, are we unable to ask the difficult question? So I have colleagues who've taught in Aboriginal communities, in isolated Aboriginal communities, where students attend class sporadically. These communities have trouble keeping the teachers there. That's because they have trouble keeping the students in the class. And the reason the students aren't in the class is because they're sniffing gasoline and are high. The drug of choice, because it's cheap. And where are their parents? At home drunk. We need to talk about that. Have I just been politically incorrect? Did it sound like I just blamed Aboriginal communities for their distress? Careful, ladies and gentlemen. I did not blame the community. What I did do is challenge the community. Something's wrong if both the adult and the child is addicted. We need to talk about that. We need to challenge those communities. The outsider just can't come in. How do we deal with that? Sorry, if you're looking for an easy answer, I don't know of one. I do know if we don't confront the problem straight out, flat out, we won't solve it. Notice. Please notice, ladies and gentlemen, every time we get near a solution, every time we think about a problem carefully, a social action problem, every time we do that, ever notice? We start getting into dangerous territory. We get near something powerful that may not like our questions, whether they're about climate change, or tobacco use, or substance abuse. The list goes on. How will you change the world? And everyone will like you. Not happening in this universe. So now you see, some of you, maybe the ones, well, I like that those, all the faces aren't 20. Those of you a little older might start thinking, oh, I know where this character's coming from. I know where this old guy's coming from. He's an old student from the 1960s, and he's sneaking in some kind of revolutionary, down with the man, up with the revolution kind of argument. Ha ha, he's waited this long, and now he was a member of the Students for a Democratic Society, the SDS, because they planted bombs and a variety of other things. Now, do not look at me like I'm advocating the 1960s crazed rhetoric, anti-capitalist establishment, down with the man. Oh, please, ladies and gentlemen, what did that accomplish? What did that accomplish? So now you're going to get angry that there is injustice in the world. You're going to get angry that there are corrupt agencies. Like, surprise, surprise, there are, you know, powerful corrupt players all around the world. Yeah, well, get angry, but that's not going to do you any good either. We tried the anger. It doesn't work. We tried the empty sloganeering. It doesn't work either. See, we've always looked. Yes, and my generation did too. They looked for easy answers. Huff and puff and shout and demo. I even carried a picket sign once. I know you were so cautious people. If you had a kind of picket sign, you'd actually faint from the fright of it all. You're going to change the world and can't hold up the damn sign. God, that's... But it didn't do any good for us. Because it had no sustained effort. It had no creativity. We wouldn't ask the awkward questions. I'm sorry, I'm pointing at you saying you should ask awkward questions. I'm not sure I and my generation asked those awkward questions either, because we didn't ask them, because we thought we had an answer and it was glib and easy. If only the old people would get out of the road, paradise would break out. Yeah, right, now I'm an old person. Remember, my generation said, don't trust anyone over 30. Now I don't trust anyone under 30. That's not coherent. So maybe we all have to move beyond this rhetoric. I don't mind if you're genuinely angry, but you better focus it into something meaningful, like your brain. You have to think carefully. And always, always, as you think carefully, say, how can I do it faster? How can I push? Oh, see? Don't be self-satisfied that you, oh, I have an idea that works. Now you have to say, I have an idea that works faster. Just like commercial entrepreneurs, whoa, I have an idea, they say, they're so happy. I say, is this the best idea you've ever had? They say, I have an idea. I say, is this the best idea you've ever had? It turns out it's the only idea they've ever had. And on my door, there's a sign that says, there's nothing more dangerous than a person with an idea, if that's the only one he has. That's true for the commercial entrepreneur, true for the social entrepreneur. You must understand that when we are advancing these new initiatives on entrepreneurship, all the fundamental principles of entrepreneurship that apply to the commercial venture apply to the social venture at least as urgently. And if your goal is more urgent than commercial gain, then all of these rules apply to you more. So, are you ready to ask those awkward questions? First of yourself, am I too self-satisfied? First of yourself, am I being as creative as I can? First to yourself, do I have the courage to challenge the status quo? Do I have the challenge to challenge conventional wisdom? Do I have the courage to conduct an experiment and live by its results? Those are the questions you have to ask yourselves, ladies and gentlemen. Only you can answer them. I can make no comment about where you find courage. But if you're planning to change the world, really change it. Courage is what you need. Melvin's waiting to be rescued. This trip took place in 2008. Means Melvin's 15, assuming he's still alive. And his youngest brother is 9. They're waiting. And millions of other people around the world, in at least as difficult circumstances, are waiting. And they can't wait forever. So, ladies and gentlemen, so go really change the world. Thank you. Thank you. Yep, we can do questions.
Professor Schmidt, what do you think of the benefits or drawbacks of Grameen Bank in Bangladesh and microcredit around the world in general?
Oh, microcredit? It's a wonderful idea, if only it would change the world. Again, you see, microcredit and lending circles. These have been very helpful. They've helped many poor people get access to credit, start small, viable businesses, as has been especially important to empower women. so that they can actually make a contribution to the family, financial contribution to their families, given that some of their male companions are lazy louts. So this says that's the truth, as it turns out. And while that's helpful, the problem is not helpful enough, not helpful fast enough. It has not been scaled up as quickly as some of its proponents had hoped for. So again, my same problem would be that it's a good thing to do. We should have more of it. But if it's in a chaotic environment, which it often is, then the potential of that venture is not realized. Please shout, sir.
I'd like you to reconcile two conflicting interests that I think exist here. First, the need for urgency and the need for having an impact that affects the entire world, right? You're addressing a crowd of students who have very limited resources. How do you balance the need to go act immediately versus building up your influence and power and being able to make that big impact?
Well, it's a contradiction. You're quite right. This whole thing is about contradictions. That's why it's so hard to wrap your head around it, to celebrate and lament at the same time, to take global action and to take it quickly, and the fact that you're young and don't have much power and don't have much, and don't have much influence. Well, again, you say I don't have an easy answer to the observation. One of the reasons that I want to be here, really want to be here, is because I am hoping the freshness of your brain. I'm hoping your brain with less baggage than my brain. I'm sorry, I have baggage. I may have a little more experience. Well, I do have more experience too, because I'm alive longer. But I may have assumed away some solutions just because without even noticing it. The clarity and the freshness of your mind is your great advantage. So maybe one of the things you have to do is first find better ways to do this. Find ways to resolve some of these contradictions, and then go find some old person who's rich. I'm not being funny. There are older persons who are also frustrated by the slow pace of change. There are older persons who actually want to see the change in the world before they're dead. And it is, for example, just to give you the parallel with commercial entrepreneurs, because the parallels are very tight, commercial entrepreneurs often are very aided by mentors who are their so-called also angel investors. And one of the reasons that young commercial entrepreneurs can get angel investors is these older persons have money and they want to be young one more time, to live vicariously through the venture of the younger person. Like, why could you not apply that principle, right, to a social venture? I do not see it. Works for commercial ventures. Why should it not work for you? It speaks to your power of advocacy. So what a young person is going to have to do who doesn't have immediate power and influence is find an idea that works, try to test it on limited scale as much as you can, and then advocate it to get the resources you need to do it now, not when you're 45. Like, again, there are many other models to deal with it. I am much taken by the social entrepreneurship of Mike Lazaridis, because remember, Mike Lazaridis, you may think, for example, is a commercial entrepreneur primarily. He's the founder of Research in Motion. Truth be told, his primary motivation was, and I know this for a fact because he told me when he was 22, not when he told me now when he was 22, that his goal, while Perimeter is just a vehicle, his goal is, while RIM is just a half idea in his head, if he can be financially successful, he will build a not-for-profit scientific research institute because there aren't enough of them and nobody supports pure science. He's trying to change the world by changing our understanding of what constitutes fundamental reality, a la physics. Now, so he decided, since nobody was going to support this, since 90% of the population can't even understand what's going on at Perimeter, even if they think really hard about it, so don't bother trying, but he concluded he'd have to get rich and fund it himself. Now, that's another model. So maybe you have to get rich first. Buy one sports car to satisfy yourself. And then change the world. Given your vision of how to do it. Yes?
So my question is basically, in developing countries, right, where there's so much political instability, and you want to start something, so how do you combat that? Like, I know there's no one answer for that, but, like, where the corruption is so great that you can't even combat that, like, What's your advice on that?
Okay, the corruption is so great you can't combat it, but in fact you must. The corruption in many countries is so great that it cannot work. I have watched. Remember, my classroom was often populated by people who had to flee their countries because their countries drove them away. I have had students in my office near tears because their country made them leave. Because if they stayed, they had no future. They could not use their talent. They would not be able to even help their families because that was an impossibility. They would describe examples of a family member starting an enterprise, doing everything that they're supposed to create jobs and provide value to a community. And as soon as it got successful, the powerful, corrupt forces simply took it from them. As simple as that. And they could not complain, or they would go to jail and never disappear. That's the world in which we live. Now, there's only two conclusions if, again, we're going to be follow the thought to its logic conclusion. You either abandon that country and pursue your opportunities elsewhere, but then that is often a difficult decision. And do we want to abandon whole countries and then wait for them to reform themselves? Because that's not, you may wait, again, you may wait till half the children are all dead, or you get creative about it. You find ways from outside to reveal the corruption, because most corrupt governments have corrupted someone outside the government, often, for example, in a developed country with at least half organized judicial system. So maybe, you see, when you talk to Bill Gates next, you might suggest that if he put $500 million into investigative journalism to find every example of corruption emanating from a developing world, which has, because largely speaking, when there's corruption in the developing world, it's because somebody from outside is bribing somebody. So if you can't deal with the internal country, deal with the external. Now that, of course, pisses off a lot of vested corporate interests here who find it awkward. Well, so be it. Again, no easy answer, but I'm sorry, part of that may well be confrontational. I mean, you might conclude, again, this is what you've got to do. You've got to think about all of these different possibilities. You have to think in different ways than you may have thought thus far. So for those of you who want to change the world, maybe what you really want to do is create a powerful investigative private charity, where the private charity does not provide seeds for farms or vaccines for children. What this charitable endeavor is a bunch of avenging investigative reporters, and they shine the light of day on the threads of corruption which span the world. Hmm? Well, no, but again, you see, that's aggressive. It's provocative. You will need some support. It's an old rich person who wants to be the journalist who brings down the President of the United States. See, I lived through Watergate. I lived through the day-by-day unraveling of the presidency of Richard Milhouse Nixon. The journalist destroyed him. Mm-hmm. A good president, don't you think? Except we don't do that very often anymore, do we? And it would have to be done from outside the country, because inside the country, the journalists would be killed. Yeah. Well, they would. That's the truth. I'm not being provocative. That's just descriptive. We're talking about life and death here. I'm sorry, we are. Children who live or die. Adults who are persecuted for every manner of reason. Like I said, can't you hear the clock ticking? Since this presentation began, some people have, their lives are now gone. 40%, it is estimated that 40% of the prisoners in Brazilian jails have not yet been sentenced, because the judicial system has basically collapsed and nobody cares. Yes?
To change the world, must we first reform ourselves before we go out into the...
Oh, I don't know that I want to reform you. I do want you to think more aggressively. I want you to confront hard truths about the difficulty of what we need to do the obstacles facing us and the fact that, you know, to be doing something that's charitable, you know, you tell your family, you tell your friends, you tell your community, you know what the temptation is? Congratulations, young person. Dad is so good. They, you know, generally speaking, Dad will be like, oh, so good, so good. But you see, if you're really doing something, everybody's not going to like you. So are you prepared to be controversial? Are you prepared for someone to call you an idiot or worse? If everyone has to like you, you're not changing the world. You're not. Okay, one last question. I think one last. Go ahead.
Wouldn't the current economic system and structure have to be completely removed? So growth-centered policy and money-centered policy have to be removed in order for change to happen because they have too much power to hold the entire system.
I'll just repeat the question so the recording picks it up. If the question asked, is our economic system so tilted to power that it has to change before we can have these reforms? Did I characterize that question properly? Well, the answer is maybe. I'm trying to answer it seriously. I happen to think not. I happen to think that marketplace economies are imperfect, and I would make them more perfect, falling from the words of my hero, Adam Smith, who wanted more competition. So if you see corruption, I see not enough competition. Now, I respect if we differ about the solutions. However, if you're saying that there are issues that are about the fundamental economic organization of the planet and certainly many of its countries, the answer is yes. There are situations where powerful entities simply do what they want. There are certain countries for which this is true. There may be certain industries in this country for which this is true. Now, the solutions for that might vary all over the place, from a fundamentally different system, which would be your right to advocate. I happen not to think it's necessary, but that's, okay, that's just me. But that we must all ask penetrating questions about how we economically organize ourselves. And for example, are there sufficient controls or regulations on the abuses which might naturally occur? Those are important questions to be asked, largely not asked. And if you want to ask them, sir, I salute you to do so. Who knows what the answers might be? More provocative than either of us might suppose.
So, on behalf of St. Paul's Renos, I'd like to thank you, Larry, for your thoughtful presentation on changing the world.
My pleasure, Larry. Thank you. So go do it. So now I'm saying go do it. Then I will applaud too.
Yes.